In 45 years of trying to live a fulfilling life, there is one question that never leaves me. How does one pursue all the varied interests that one has amidst the harsh reality of earning one's living, which requires one to invest a significant amount of time in excelling at one thing? As a young parent, I had just set up a new business and felt drawn to learning martial arts, Russian ballet, and Sanskrit language. What was I to do? Give all these dreams up as impractical, so unrelated and diverse that you could not even combine them in any meaningful way towards something useful or cogent, or explore all of them like an adventure and see where they lead me? While the first option of giving all these dreams up as impractical was easier, I chose the second one of exploring all of them, and something magical happened. Let me share that with you. Have you ever felt that you're good at many things, but when you compare yourself to an expert at any one of those things, you are mediocre? Well, all through my school and college days, I felt that way. I enjoyed doing a variety of things, like performing arts, debating, academics, but I wasn't a trailblazer in any of them. This led to a sort of complex in me. Was I best at anything at all? I wondered. Which career suited a person like me? I was headed towards a full-blown identity crisis until three events changed my perspective and gave me the answer. The first was a visit to a ballet performance. What comes to your mind when I talk to you about the conductor of an orchestra or a ballet? Someone who just moves her hands around? That's what I used to think too, until I got a chance to observe closely what a conductor actually does. And what I found was that she not only enabled the smooth transitions between all the instruments, but ensured that the 50 musicians in the orchestra and the 30 dancers on the stage, they all started, performed, and ended in complete synchrony. It was a hard and a strenuous task. I saw her change her shirt multiple times, almost after every act, because she was sweating so much. And when I looked closer, I saw that she perhaps did not play the violin as perfectly as the violinist, or the piano as dexterously as the pianist, if you were to compare her individually with each of the musicians, but she had the ability to understand the nuances of every instrument, make them play together, and create a beautiful symphony out of it. And that's when it struck me that you don't have to be spending your entire life training to be an expert in just one field or discipline to have a successful career. You can have a successful career by including all your talents into what you do, or even have multiple careers, like Da Vinci, who was an artist, a sculptor, an architect, a mathematician, all rolled into one. The second event was a meeting with my professor of systems thinking, Dr. D.P. Dash, at the Xavier Institute of Management, Bhubaneswar, where I was pursuing my MBA, who assured me that someone with my varied interests and capabilities would make an ideal candidate for an entrepreneur or a CEO who could see the big picture and take everyone along. And finally, it was my introduction to Sri Aurobindo, the 20th century Indian philosopher, and his principles of holistic and integral education that not only helped me come to terms with my eclectic interests, but inspired me to celebrate my multifacetedness. I began to understand that the journey of my life will not be squandered away, but enhanced through multiple pursuits. And then there was no stopping me. From the corporate sector, I moved on to become an entrepreneur and set up diverse businesses in engineering, publishing, and healthcare. A few years later, reinventing myself as an educator, I headed an international school, and today I am setting up an alternative university for mountain development in the Trans-Himalayan region of Ladakh. At 33, when ballerinas retire, I ventured into ballet, went on to dancing on point shoes, and performing on stage. At 34, I began learning karate with my son Aryan. We earned our black belts together and eventually the World Karate Championship in 2009 at Pittsburgh. When I started learning one thing after the other, it was great fun. I was enjoying the thrill of learning new things. I was on a high, as it were. But it was only later that I began to understand and gain deep insights into the learning process. Ballet and karate, aren't they opposite? One requires your hand to move gracefully, while the other requires the same hand to be strong enough to break a wooden panel. My first insight, when we learn opposite and complementary skills, we widen the range of what we can do and achieve. I could win the World Karate Championship because I could kick better and higher. You get 3 points when you kick and just one when you punch. And this kick had been perfected through the split in ballet. My second insight, I found that I was taking less and less time to learn new things. Skills learned in one activity were helping the other. I completed my black belt in 7 months, which takes 3 to 4 years, because the kinesthetic intelligence developed as a dancer on one hand, and the fitness developed through sports and yoga accelerated my karate training. I could set up diverse businesses because the skills of understanding the dynamics of every business as a management consultant, coupled with the risk-taking ability inculcated by my parents through an independent upbringing, gave me the confidence. I could learn languages faster and completed the study of Sanskrit's Panini's grammar in 9 months again, which is a very short time. Because all the components of language, morphology, semantics, syntax, and grammar had been developed through the 4 languages that I had learned earlier. Thirdly, I found that I was looking at things more creatively as I could make uncanny associations between different subjects, between different fields. I would surprise everyone at school by winning the discus throw competition against very strong contenders, despite being puny in size, because I had just learned to perfect the angle of throw by applying what I had studied in physics, that anything thrown at 45-degree angle goes the farthest. Here I found resonance with Nobel laureate Stephen Chu, who is an American physicist and the former US Secretary of State, who, when asked the key to his success, said that he changes his area of research every 4 to 5 years. This helps him connect the dots of prior knowledge in unexpected ways and come up with new discoveries. Realize that everything is connected to everything else, says Da Vinci, meaning that one has to learn several disciplines to understand the reality that is composite. And therefore, these insights led me to probe further. What does lifelong learning actually do to us? And what I ended up discovering was that when we keep learning new and different things, we enlarge our education from the 3 R's of just reading, writing, and arithmetic to the 3 H's of head, heart, and hands, corresponding to the emotions, head, and the body, the 3 building blocks of what we call ourselves, thereby making us more and more rounded and effective individuals. Now, emotions are the seat of our will, power, and energy. They can be positive or negative. While positive emotions like love, gratitude, generosity, courage, compassion and selflessness can be life-enhancing, negative ones like fear, hatred, anger, jealousy, resentment can be clearly life-stultifying. Personal transformation, therefore, is the process through which we understand our emotions, educate them, cultivate the positive ones, and neutralize the negatives. Selflessness, for instance, can be developed by doing something every day without any expectation of money or recognition. True generosity is not giving away something you don't need, but being truly happy in other person's happiness. Courage is not the lack of fear, but the overcoming of it. I identify a fear every year to overcome. I was mortally afraid of heights. So 4 years ago, I decided to skydive. And the moment before the jump at 15,000 feet was a life-transforming moment where I was liberated from fear and felt a new individual. Likewise, mental development is also very important, and it has three levels of wideness, depth, and height. Wideness is the training of the mind to learn many subjects so that one can see things from several points of view. Depth is not to study these subjects superficially, but to go deep into it and plunge and study in it all its nuances. And height is taking a step back from all the subjects one has learned and trying to find an interconnection between them, because at some point they do connect to a larger picture. And it is at the cross-section of these disciplines that new disciplines are born. Take the case of Vitruvian Man created by Da Vinci. It symbolizes and represents a synthesis of art, anatomy, mathematics, religion, spirituality, architecture, and gives us a new insight into the proportions of human body and how the geometry of the human reflects the geometry of the universe. This is the produce of a mind that has been developed in its wideness, depth, and height. And finally, physical development. It is to consciously develop stamina, strength, flexibility, and endurance in our bodies by focusing on the right kind of diet, exercise, work, and nutrition. The crowning glory of physical perfection is reached when we glow with health and youthfulness. And when all these three instruments, the emotions, mind, and body, are perfected through lifelong learning and work in harmony, their conductor, which is us, can produce the most beautiful symphony, a fulfilled life. So as a young parent who had started a new business, I indeed went on to learning karate, ballet, and even Sanskrit, while setting up businesses in engineering, healthcare, and publishing, one by one, systematically in search of this fulfilled life. Now, I may never become a Maya Plisetskaya or a Margaret Fonteyn, the legendary prima ballerinas of their times, but ballet, the grace and freedom of movement that I have attained through it, has revealed to me that learning not only transcends age, but in some sense even reverses it. When we keep learning new things, we stay and feel perennially young. Likewise, I may never become a Bruce Lee or a Van Damme, but karate taught me to bounce back after every setback, to never give up, and to stay calm. And to stay calm through all the vicissitudes of life. It brought me face to face with my fears and taught me how to conquer them. I may never become a Rockefeller or an Anita Roddick, but entrepreneurship taught me to take risks, to negotiate tough situations, to understand human nature, and to build successful teams and partnerships. And today, I'm bringing all these learnings of a management professional, of an entrepreneur, of an educator, the grace of a dancer, the resilience of a martial artist, to set up in the freezing minus temperatures of Ladakh, Himalayan Institute of Alternatives, the world's first doers university that combines entrepreneurship, academics, research, and experiential learning. The vision of Hyal is to empower the youth from the mountain regions with the education which is relevant and contextual to them so that they can live a life of dignity in harmony with nature. And this we do by finding real-life solutions to real-time problems using local resources, inventions, and interventions. This is the shot I took from the airplane 2 years ago when on the left what you see was the 200 acres of desert land allotted to us by the government to set up the university. And on the right is an artist's impression of how the university should be in 10 years or to come. And today, after a year, this is how the university looks. And if you look closer, there are lots of experiments happening here. For instance, in the Trans-Himalayan Desert, we are piloting a forest growing technique which makes the forest survive in this 12,000 high altitude desert in order to solve the problems of greenery and flash floods. Similarly, what you see, another small dot there, are pilots for earth building techniques so that they stay at plus 20 when it is minus 20 outside without any need for artificial heating. Also, to solve the water problem, we create artificial reservoirs so that they store the winter water, which can be used in spring. And through this, we combine the four principles of Hyal, a curriculum that is contextual, a pedagogy that is experiential, an approach that is transdisciplinary, and a problem-solving methodology which is a blend of indigenous wisdom and modern technology. So Hyal is that canvas on which I could combine all the dots and the dream-led aspirations of my personality. It is the platform where all my interests find expression, including I'm teaching karate to the students there through an initiative, Peaceful Warriors, to make every girl in India a black belt. So how to pursue all the varied interests that one has while making practical ends meet was finally answered. The inner realization that preceded the epiphany was that it can only be done when the aim of our life shifts from outer success and worldly recognition to inner growth and spiritual transformation. In the words of Rumi, when I run after what I want, my days are like a furnace filled with anxiety and stress. When I sit quietly, what I want flows to me on its own. I realize then that what I want wants me too. There's a big secret here for anyone who can grasp it.